There was a time, not very long ago, when we lived in an enchanted world of elegant palaces and grand parties. The year was 1916, and my son, Nicholas, was the Tsar of Imperial Russia.
You're listening to Revolution Under Siege, a podcast from the 1919 Review about the Russian Civil War. To find a text version of this podcast, look up 1919review.wordpress.com. This episode of Revolution Under Siege introduces the White Guards, the counter-revolutionary armies who tried to overthrow the October Revolution. We're going to start relying heavily on the memoirs of General Denikin. So, January 1918, 4,000 armed men had gathered by the Don River to begin a counter-revolution that would shake Russia for years to come. This week, we're going to take a closer look at the White Guards, and then we're also going to look at the Cossacks, and we will look at how things went down when the White Guards and the Cossacks had to face the Red Guards for the first time in early 1918. In a kind of prologue to the Civil War proper. General Anton Denikin first met General Lavra Kornilov on the plains of Galicia at the start of the Great War. Their units fought side by side in what Denikin called incessant, glorious and heavy battles. The thousands of men led by Denikin and Kornilov fought their way over the Carpathian Mountains and down into Hungary. Denikin was really struck by Kornilov's ability to train up, quote, second-rate units into, quote, excellent condition, by his scrupulousness and by his personal prowess as a warrior. Later in the war, Kornilov became a celebrity after he broke out of an Austrian prison following his capture. Denikin and Kornilov both came from relatively humble backgrounds, which is very interesting, because the following was Denikin's take on what had gone wrong with Russia. So I'm paraphrasing him in what follows, with the odd quote. Back in the old days, Russian military officers were generally noble, or at the very least bourgeois in origin. But in these latter days, the gates of the officer training schools had been flung open to, quote, people of low extraction. With the result that the officer corps had, quote, completely lost its character as a class and as a caste. And these are the words of Denikin himself. So, in other words, a bit like Groucho Marx.
So after the third week, I sent him a telegram and says, please accept my resignation. I don't want to belong to any club that will accept me as a member.
The old bonds that had held the army together, the church, the monarchy, grew weak. This was reflective of the general weakening of the moral fabric of society under the corrupting influence of city life. Workers were motivated by base material desires rather than spiritual riches. The icon in the corner, the workshop, in other words, no longer sufficed to satisfy them. So there came two disastrous wars. The war with Japan in 1904-05, and then the Great War beginning in 1914. In 1415, the old army, what was left of it, quote, as a class and as a caste, was broken under the German, Austrian and Turkish guns. It was an absolutely terrible war. There were crippling shortages of rifles, uniforms and shells. Over 2 million soldiers of the Russian army perished in this war. The civilian deaths, the wounded, the prisoners of war, each of these categories also numbered in the millions. Carleton sums it up, For 3 years, quote, Russian soldiers were sent into battle without rifles or were deliberately shelled by their own when in their trenches they were understandably reluctant to go over the top. Many officers fought with great courage and prowess, but all too often they saw their gains thrown away through incompetence, corruption, stupidity, and shortages. Even these officers grew angry with the government. According to General Denikin again, it's hardly necessary to prove that the enormous majority of the commanding officers were thoroughly loyal to the monarchist idea and to the Tsar himself. This flies in the face of what we are told by our English language secondary sources, who assure us that many of the officers were liberal Republicans. Anyway, regardless of what their politics were, we can all agree that they, instead of blaming the Tsar himself, they blamed the Tsar's German wife, and they obsessed about a certain mad monk. Too many histories talk too much about him, and ignore much more important factors. Anyway, they blamed everything on the corrupting influence of this mad monk.
You think you can banish the great Rasputin? By the unholy powers vested in me, I banish you with a curse! Mark my words, you and your family will die within a fortnight. I will not rest until I see the end of the Romanov line.
Then came the February Revolution. The high-ranking officers were completely blindsided by this mass popular revolt in Petrograd. And as they absorbed the news of the downfall of the Tsar, the unthinkable news, they suffered a tumult of emotions. First, they were disappointed in themselves. They surely should have engineered a palace coup in order to head off such a movement. But they were also angry at the moderate politicians who had stepped into the void, at these vulgar scoundrels who had abolished the monarchy. They were also fearful of the tidal wave of workers' power and of the growing mutinies in the army and the navy. They were outraged that the peoples of Finland, Ukraine, Poland, the Baltic states and the Caucasus wanted self-determination. This amounted in the eyes of the officers to the dismemberment of Holy Russia. In the words of Denikin, these people were Russian in spirit and in blood. In general, the mood among the top brass was resigned, despondent. But there was a sneaking hope that something good might come out of the revolution. It might reinvigorate the army. It might give it morale to win the war. Denikin would carefully distinguish between, quote, the real democracy, by which he meant, in his own words, the bourgeoisie and the civil service, and the, quote, revolutionary democracy, which were the socialist parties, whose supporters were, again in his words, semi-cultured and illiterate. So if the real democracy could get the upper hand over the revolutionary democracy, things might yet be salvaged. But the portents were not good. Denikin met his old comrade-in-arms Kornilov for the first time since the revolution at a dinner in the house of the war minister in late March. He found him tired, morose, and pessimistic. The condition of the Petrograd garrison was beyond comprehension to Kornilov. They were holding political meetings. They were engaging in petty trade. They were hiring themselves out as private guards. He spoke in late March, a few weeks after the February Revolution, of, quote, the inevitability of a fierce cleansing of Petrograd, end quote. Time passed, and thanks to a Soviet decree, the death penalty was abolished, and the officer no longer held the power of life and death over the men. And soon after that, the Soviet decreed that officers had to answer to elected committees of the rank and file, and this was an incredible humiliation in the eyes of men born and raised and trained to value rigid hierarchy. The men, it now appeared, held power of life and death over the officers, and this was confirmed when sailors at Kronstadt massacred 50 officers. The officer corps hated the new provisional government for pandering to the Soviet, and they loathed the Soviet itself. The soldiers' delegates were, they complained, a bunch of clerks and shiftless rear garrison men. The proceedings of the Soviet were a vulgar display of ignorance and coarseness. Returning to Denikin and his fascinating memoirs again, he pointedly listed by nationality the personnel of the Presidium of the Soviet Central Committee. Quote, one Georgian, five Jews, one Armenian, one Pole, one Russian. And then in brackets after that, if his name was not an assumed one. End quote. To Denikin, this was proof that the Soviet was dominated by, quote, an alien element foreign to the Russian national idea, end quote. And in my opinion, Denikin should make up his mind. Were the peoples of the border states Russian in spirit and blood, or were they an alien element foreign to the Russian national idea? It seems when they wanted independence, they were Russian, but when they held high office, they were alien. Anyway, then of course there's the question of anti-Semitism. When the officers spoke of the socialist leader Trotsky, they always called him Bronstein or Bronstein Trotsky, as if they were thereby making a very important point, as if it was a gotcha. The Constitutional Democrat Party was a bastion of Denikin's real democracy, business owners and bureaucrats. After the July days, which were a near revolution that was confined to Petrograd, the Constitutional Democrats and top brass of the military began to collaborate in earnest. The figurehead of this movement was General Lavr Kornilov. In August 1917, the cadets, the Constitutional Democrats, carried him on their shoulders and cheered him to the rafters. Kornilov made his move in August-September. This was a murky affair for the simple reason that it began as him and the provisional government leader Kerensky collaborating against the Soviet. But then, thanks to a miscommunication, it ended up being a conflict between Kornilov and Kerensky. So it ended up being Kerensky and the Soviet against Kornilov, when it was supposed to be Kornilov and Kerensky against the Soviet. Anyway, this misunderstanding surely wouldn't have taken place if there wasn't grounds for distrust between these two forces. The military reaction around Kornilov and the provisional government, the middle-class democratic elements. Anyway, he issued an ultimatum and marched on the capital. In his own words,
"It's time to hang these German spies with Lenin at their head and disperse the Soviet. I want to move a corps within striking distance of the capital so that when the Bolsheviks demonstrate, we can humble the traitors as they deserve."
But the attempted coup was not just a failure. It backfired and strengthened the Bolsheviks. Denikin, whom we have been quoting from time to time, was one of Kornilov's co-conspirators. After the failed coup, Denikin ended up in a cell 7 foot square. In early mornings, soldiers would cling to the bars of the window to curse and threaten him. And here I'm quoting from those memoirs again. "He wanted to open the front. He sold himself to the Germans. He wanted to deprive us of land and freedom. You have drunk our blood, ordered us about, kept us stewing in prison. Now we are free and you can sit behind the bars yourself. You pampered yourself, drove about in motor cars. Now you can try what lying on a wooden bench is, you blank. You have not much time left. We shan't wait till you run away. We will strangle you with our own hands." Denikin covered himself with his cloak, as if to hide from them. In that moment, all he could think was, "What have I done to deserve this?" He thought back over his life, his humble origins, his promotion on his own merits, his valour in combat. By the standards of the institution he served, he had always been relatively kind to the men under his command, in that he declined to beat them up. As he thought over it all, his rage mounted. In these things the soldiers were saying to him, there was much injustice. And he rose, throwing aside his cloak. Quote, "You lie, soldier. It is not your own words that you are speaking. If you are not a coward hiding in the rear, if you have been in action, you have seen how your officers could die." End quote. His tormentors, awed by his words and unable to contradict them, retreated. Not all the soldiers were hostile. Quote, "On the first cold night, when we had none of our things, a guard brought Markov, who had forgotten his overcoat, a soldier's overcoat. But half an hour later, whether he had grown ashamed of his good action or whether his comrades had shamed him, he took it back." The failed coup of August-September was just the start of the Kornilov movement. That is an important point that many people miss. There is a consistent through line from the Kornilov movement to the White Guards. Kornilov and all his co-conspirators ended up imprisoned at Bykov Monastery. Bykov was just down the road from the General Staff HQ. There, Alexeyev, Kornilov's successor as commander-in-chief, and Dukhonin, his successor in turn, both kept in close contact with Kornilov. So Kornilov, through proxies, was able to carry on his work as if he was at liberty, and to build an underground league of officers and cadets. So the provisional government, as if it had a death wish or something, appointed in turn three commanders-in-chief of the army who hated the guts of the provisional government and was plotting to replace it with a military dictatorship. It is true that they were in favour of a temporary military dictatorship, one that would not remain in power forever. Its task would be to, quote, restore order. Once order was restored, in other words, once all the working class leaders were dead or imprisoned and their parties crushed, once the Soviet was liquidated, once the slums were stained with blood and rubble and craters, once order was restored, the power would be handed to a legitimate government. Perhaps this legitimate government would be another absolute monarchy, like under Nicholas II. Many of the officers, in fairness, were for a constitutional monarchy, some were even for a republic. The important point is there could be, possibly, elections once order was restored. In other words, we can have election just as soon as there's absolutely no chance of the lefties winning that election. We are regularly informed by historians that the white movement embraced the full spectrum of political opinion from monarchist to social democrat. In reality, there were no leftists among the Kornilovite officers. That's a separate development that we're going to look at in future posts, where some moderate socialists, so-called, allied themselves. But this was not the case in January 1918. It would further spoil the impression of a broad movement to point out that the spectrum includes reactionary and proto-fascist. The monarchists, by the way, were not people who thought the royal family were good for tourism and good for gossip columns. They were deadly serious defenders of absolute monarchy, whose only criticism of the old regime was that it was perhaps too liberal. But the white officers themselves placed very little stock in all these political questions. They uttered the P word with distaste, a distaste they otherwise reserved for Bronstein.
What's the position there, Lieutenant? This has been a long journey. We've had little news.
It's a madhouse. Peasants and soldiers pouring in from all over the province in their thousands. Meetings and demonstrations on every street corner. The Tarida Palace is bedlam. Workers and soldiers' deputies holding committee meetings in every room, even in the corridors. We Russians have a passion for holding meetings.
When a people finds its voice for the first time, it has a lot to say.
There's so many parties. Committees for this, committees for that. Subcommittees, delegations, deputations.
And what is your assessment of the political situation? What kind of reception shall we receive?
I'm a soldier. I know nothing of politics.
The political questions could be settled after order was restored. They would always say stuff like, I'm a mere soldier and not a politician. And they had the doctrine of non-predetermination. They had neither the right nor the desire to predetermine the results of some future election. And put one way, this seems all very fine and all very democratic. Put another way, it reveals that what really mattered was not the form of government that was to follow. What mattered was the fierce cleansing. As always, the most political question of all is what questions you regard as political and what questions you regard as non-political. But all these plans anyway were superseded. The other side struck first. The other side was better prepared, better organized for once in history. The October Revolution took place. The provisional government and its few defenders were hapless. But on the right, the Kornilov movement was not caught completely off guard. To cut a long story short, they staged risings both in Moscow and in Petrograd in a series of bloody episodes over several days and weeks. It was in Moscow that the counter-revolutionaries first received the nickname White Guards from their enemies. This was a reference to the French Revolution, because white was the colour of the Bourbon monarchy that was overthrown in that revolution. If it was supposed to be an insult, it backfired. The White Guards adopted the name with pride. But in both Moscow and in Petrograd and in other places such as Irkutsk, they were defeated. In Petrograd, their leader, General Krasnov, was released on parole. In Moscow, the surrendered White Guards were all allowed to walk away, some still carrying their arms. After defeat in the two great cities, Generals Kornilov and Alexeyev decided to play a longer game. They gave the order to rendezvous in the far south of Russia by the River Don, where they had stockpiled, reportedly, 22,000 rifles. Thousands of individual officers began the journey south. Peasants and soldiers did not show the same clemency as the authorities in Petrograd and Moscow. Quote, the fugitive officer en route for the south became an outlaw figure for the soldiers to be killed on sight, end quote. But these officers persevered in spite of the threat to their lives. Many survived the journey by throwing aside the red shoulder boards that marked them out as officers. Others disposed of their uniforms entirely and would go on to fight in civilian clothes. Kornilov simply rode out of his prison at Bykov Monastery and set off for the Don at a trot. His guards, so-called, had actually joined him as his bodyguard. And when he reached Novocherkassk by the Don, he found General Alexeyev and 400 volunteers already mustered. The weeks passed and 400 grew to 4,000. I want to add a brief note here about those officers who did not join the White Guards, because there were about 500,000 officers in the Russian army at this point, because the army was like 9 million strong. Only a small number actually went into the Whites. The vast majority just went home to live quietly in peace. They had quite enough of fighting and they weren't going to go and die for a lost cause. Some went into hiding, like General Brusilov. Others still went on to loyally serve the Soviet regime. There was a general named Sitin, and here comes my customary apology for my inability to pronounce Slavic names properly, who simply said that, quote, the people cannot be wrong. Even though he was of a conservative mindset himself, he was not willing to betray the people, and he would go along with their democratic decision as he saw it. There were many other examples of conscientious public servants, or just of sensible people who just went home. In other words, these thousands who gathered by the River Don, they had other options. They didn't have to do this. They bear political responsibility for doing this.
In the autumn of 1917, Cossacks were coming back from the war to the villages of the Don region.
The southern Russian lands, north of the Caucasus Mountains and between the Black Sea and the Caspian, had, in living memory, borne witness to a war far more fierce and total than the Russian Civil War. In the 19th century, the Russian Empire had massacred and exiled the Muslim Circassian people who were native to that country. The Cossacks settled on rich black soil stolen from the Circassians, and especially the Kuban Cossacks, I believe, they adopted the style of the vanquished. Long, narrow-waisted coats, silver-inlaid daggers. Later on, non-Cossack immigrants flooded into these lands. They were despised by the Cossacks. They were called aliens. They were treated much as many immigrants are treated in Western countries today. The Cossacks were a privileged military caste, settled on the borders of Russia, sworn to serve in the army. Their history went back hundreds of years. They fought on horseback with swords, lances, and carbines. Again and again, the state had relied on them to crush protests. And now, true to form, the Don Cossack leaders had given a safe haven to the volunteer army, this outfit that had been set up by the officers, Kornilov, Denikin, Alexeyev, and others. But the Cossack lands were not a single conservative bloc. For many, the supposed privileges were a burden. One third of the Cossacks were poor. Equipping themselves for war put them in permanent debt. The Cossacks were outnumbered by their poor tenants, the so-called aliens, and oppressed by the big landlords. In the cities and towns, there were many artisans and workers influenced by the left-wing parties. There were towns of tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people. For the young Cossacks, the experience of World War was just as shattering as it was for young workers or young peasants. The young Cossacks witnessed all the same horrors. They shared trenches and bivouacs with the town folk who talked of revolution. And by 1917, the refrain of the young Cossacks was, we must saddle our horses and go to the Don. The war is pointless. So they made the long journey home through lands teeming with revolution. At the front lines, officers had kept order by beating and killing the rank and file soldiers. Now, as an army of 9 million men collapsed, bringing 9 million Mosin Nagant rifles and 9 million big grey greatcoats back westward. Many an officer was shot by the railway stations and the roadsides in the lawless atmosphere that prevailed. When the Cossacks came riding back into their villages, the old men called them cowards and traitors and said they had been bought off by the Reds, they had been bought off by the Jews, blah, blah, blah. But the young Cossacks had met and talked with these Reds, with these Bolsheviks, they could put faces to names. The revolution promised them an end to the war and to their military obligations and a settlement of the land question. These young frontline veterans were known as the Frontoviki. They were very uneasy at the presence of the volunteer army, at the sight of officers in their shoulder boards mustering in the Don country for a counter-revolution. So even before the October Revolution, local Soviets had taken power in 80 different towns. After October, the dam burst. Workers and peasants rose up in town after town, village after village. Bands of Red Guards took to the railways, spread Soviet power to wherever the old regime was able to hold on. In the Don country and the Kuban country, there were workers' uprisings, for example in Rostov and Taganrog, near the Don. Counter-revolution soon followed. Volunteers and Cossacks crushed the risings and shot the captured Bolshevik members of the Soviet. The leader of the Don Cossacks was Ataman Kalyadin, a cavalry general who had commanded an entire army in the Great War. He had been part of Kornilov's coup attempt, though the provisional government had never dared to prosecute him for it, because they were scared of the Cossacks. In spite of their common struggles and their successes in Rostov and Taganrog, Kornilov found Kalyadin less than fully welcoming. The volunteers were forbidden to carry arms in the Cossack capital, Novocherkassk. Kornilov's presence was no secret, but his name wasn't exactly in lights either. Kalyadin must have known that his Cossacks were not all of one mind, and that too open an allegiance to the White Guards could provoke a reaction. He declined to deepen the collaboration, and soon enough the volunteer army were packed off to the nearby town of Rostov. But important opportunities presented themselves to Kornilov. To the east, the Orenburg Cossacks had risen up. To the west, the Ukrainians had elected a Rada, or parliament, which opposed the Bolsheviks. The volunteer army would make uneasy bedfellows with Ukrainian nationalists, because the volunteer army consisted of officers who hated the idea of national independence. But the Rada had given the officers free passage over their territory, while arresting any Red Guards that strayed onto their territory. The task, therefore, was to strike out over Ukraine and link up with the Rada in Kiev and form a solid front of counter-revolution in the south. Ukrainian nationalists, Cossacks, white volunteers, Orenburg Cossacks. So, Kalyadin led his Cossacks in an invasion of the Donbass region of Ukraine. This was, as we mentioned in part one, the area where Kliment Voroshilov had worked as a miner, farm labourer, shepherd and metal worker all before his 16th birthday. It was a working-class stronghold, in other words, and Voroshilov had grown to be a key workers' leader in the area. And now, at the start of 1918, workers like Voroshilov, many thousands of them in fact under the command of Voroshilov, took up arms and barred the path of the Cossacks. There was no shortage of arms, by the way. Rifles and machine guns poured into the region from Moscow and Petrograd. So, in every mining town and in every factory town, Red Guard units sprang into existence. Here a few hundred, there a few thousand. And armoured trains thundered into the Donbass region with Siberian volunteers, Latvians, sailors, Red Guards from the big cities. The Cossacks fled back to the Don against this solid wall of revolution. We have now reached the moment at which we began, with thousands of Red Guards taking the railway south to the Don country as 1917 turned to 1918. When they reached the Donbass, the Reds divided their forces. Most rolled on to Kiev. About 16,000 Red Guards went south to the Don to face Kornilov and the Volunteer Army.
People are fighting. Where are the Bolsheviks now? Advancing from Taganrog. Tikharetsk. Voronezh. And what side are you on? Me? I'm for Soviet power. Fool. You tell him to. He's too hot, like an unbroken horse. You'll never ram it into him, father. You have nothing to ram into me. I'm not blind. What are those who come from the front saying? What can they say? We played Bolsheviks at the front. It's time to come to our senses. We don't want other people's goods. Don't touch ours, too. Think about it, Grisha. You're a smart guy. A Cossack will always be a Cossack. We don't want that lousy Russia rule on the Don. You know what the outsiders have got into their heads? To divide all the land equally. What does it mean? The outsiders, who've been living here for a long time, will be given land? The hell they will. No frigging way.
Now, in a movie or in a video game, the Red Guards would no doubt have met the White Guards in a field somewhere and fought a single decisive clear-cut battle. And in that situation, the Whites would have won, hands down. The 4,000 volunteers knew how to fight, and the Cossacks were numerous and fierce. The Reds were far from home, poorly organized, they were barely trained, they were a bunch of townies out in the middle of the countryside in the dead of winter. But there was no straight fight. These were not extras or NPCs, but human beings with doubts and fears. Each side met the other in a halting, hesitating way, one small detachment blundering into another, one outflanking and the other retreating, each unsure of the ground it stood on, politically as well as geographically, with frequent ceasefires and negotiations. The fight would jump back and forth from one railway junction or small town to the next. A railway car full of Red Guards would stop, everybody would jump out, run to the ridgeline, lie prone with their rifles out, shoot at distant figures. Anytime the Whites captured some Reds, they would immediately shoot them. These orders came directly from Kornilov, and soon the Reds were reciprocating in kind. The Reds were more in their element behind enemy lines. Small numbers were sent ahead into the Cossack lands, armed not with rifles, but with documents, such as the Soviet government's December 1917 appeal to toiling Cossacks, promising a settlement of the land question, but guaranteeing that they would not touch, quote, simple soldier Cossacks, and declaring them free of the old military obligations. All this work paid off. It may have paid off even better than the frontline fighting. In January 10th, a Congress of Cossacks met at Kamenskaya. It was the birth of a movement of Red Cossacks. Enraged, Ataman Kalyadin sent troops to arrest the delegates. But these troops went over to the Red Cossacks as well. From this point on, Kalyadin lost more and more soldiers every day that passed. Not to shells, not to bullets, but to political arguments. The Don Cossacks had suffered a decisive split between rich and poor, old and young, village and frontline. The volunteer army, however, was still superior in discipline and training. On January 15th, near Matveyev Kurgan, the burial mound of a legendary outlaw, a Red force of 10,000 suffered a bad defeat. But Matveyev Kurgan is a few hours' walk from the town of Taganrog. The workers there had risen up before and had been crushed by volunteers and Cossacks. Now they struck again as soon as they heard that the Reds were nearby. There followed 2 days of street fighting that ended on January 19th, when the Whites were chased out. The revolution had returned to Taganrog, a day's march from Rostov. Meanwhile, a second Red force of 6,000 was advancing on Novocherkask. Kalyadin's loyalists were not numerous enough to stop them. All they could do was retreat, burning railway stations and tearing up tracks as they went. Kornilov could see that the game was up for Ataman Kalyadin and his Don Cossacks. On paper, the Don hosts numbered tens of thousands, but politics had intruded into military calculations. Many had gone over to the Reds, and of those who had not, most would not answer when Kalyadin called. But to the south across the steppe was the country of the Kuban Cossacks. The Whites hoped that the Kuban Cossacks might prove more solid than the Don Cossacks. Kornilov and his volunteer army packed their bags, shouldered their rifles, and marched out onto the steppe. The Don Cossacks were incensed at this betrayal. There were shots fired at the White Guards as they fled the Don country. The volunteers had escaped out of the reach of the Red Guards from Moscow and Petrograd, but as we will see below, wherever they went, the revolution was close behind, or even lying in wait for them. The time was out of joint. In February, the Soviet government changed the calendar so that it was in step with the rest of the world. Overnight, Russia leapt ahead by 2 weeks. In South Russia, time was passing quickly in more ways than one. Ataman Kalyadin, who had commanded a whole army under the Tsars, could now call on only 100 to 140 men. He blamed Kornilov. Quote, "How can one find words for this shameful disaster?" he said in a speech before the Cossack Assembly. "We have been betrayed by the vilest kind of egotism. Instead of defending their native soil against the enemy, Russia's best sons, its officers, flee shamefully before a handful of usurpers. There is no more sense of honour or love of country, or even simple morality." After his speech, Kalyadin retired to his rooms in the Ataman's palace and shot himself in the heart. By the end of February, Novocherkassk and Rostov had fallen to the Reds. A Don Soviet Republic was founded, with an SR Cossack named Podtelkov as its president. The last supporters of the late Kalyadin galloped out into the wilderness, praying for better days. Also in the wilderness were General Kornilov and his volunteer army. And naturally, General Denikin was with them. They had marched out onto the Kuban steppe. Several thousand officers and civilians, burdened with heavy artillery and carts full of the sick and wounded. Their journey was to go down in history as the first ice march.
Towards evening of that day, a long column of soldiers wound its way out of Rostov, marching heavily over the half-melted snow. The majority were wearing officers' uniforms, and captains and colonels were in command of the platoons. In the ranks were junkers and officers of all degrees, from ensigns to colonels. Behind the numerous wagons of the baggage train came crowds of refugees, elderly, well-dressed men in overcoats and galoshes, and women wearing high-heeled shoes. In one of the companies of soldiers was Captain Listnitsky. The evening shadows gathered. A frost set in. "Have you anything to smoke?" a lieutenant asked Listnitsky. The man took the cigarette Eugene offered, thanked him, and blew his nose on his hand, soldier fashion, afterwards wiping his fingers on his coat. "You're acquiring democratic habits, Lieutenant," a lieutenant colonel smiled sarcastically. "One has to, willy-nilly. What do you do? Have you managed to salvage a dozen handkerchiefs?" The lieutenant colonel made no reply. Tiny green icicles were clinging to his reddish-gray mustache. Occasionally he snorted, frowning with the cold which pierced through his overcoat. "The flower of Russia," Listnitsky thought, glancing with keen commiseration over the ranks of the column winding along the road.
These officers were going out into the wilderness and suffering all this because they hoped to link up with the Kuban Cossack host. But the revolution made its way to the banks of the Kuban River while the volunteers were still toiling over the steppe. When they reached the Kuban Cossacks, they found the same thing they had left behind: a Cossack host that had mostly gone over to the Reds or been neutralized. And beyond lay the Caucasus front, where hundreds of thousands of veterans had mutinied and were coming north to join the revolution. February turned to March, and spring failed to come. Rain gave way to snow and cold winds, and the volunteers' clothes were crusted with ice. Under pursuit, forced to avoid railways and settlements, they are said to have fought 40 battles in 50 days. Kornilov said, "Take no prisoners, the greater the terror, the greater will be our victory." And to judge by these words, this suffering only made them more determined. He also said he was willing to murder 3/4 of the population of Russia. In April, the fortunes of the volunteer army seemed at first to turn. They joined up with a force of white Kuban Cossacks, bringing their total fighting strength to 6,000 and adding 2 more generals to their already impressive collection. They decided to march on the Kuban capital, Yekaterinodar, which is now known as Krasnodar, a city of 100,000 people. They had escaped from the Red Guards of Petrograd and Moscow. They needed the refuge and resources of a city. But where there were cities, there were workers. And where there were workers, there were Red Guards. From April 10th to 13th, the volunteer army attacked Yekaterinodar. They found 18,000 Red Guards waiting for them. The vast numbers of people who flooded into the Red Guards whenever the Whites raised their head was a sign of the legitimacy of the revolution. The fact that the Whites could at first muster only a few thousand is a reflection of their narrow, however determined, support base. Hundreds of whites were killed in the fighting. Kornilov, who was incredibly stubborn and went against the advice of his co-officers, insisted on continuing the attack. He made his HQ in a farmhouse on the edge of town, in a conspicuous place. On the morning of the 13th of April, a shell scored a direct hit on the roof, and Kornilov was killed. The volunteer army gave up the fight, and once again fled out onto the steppe. On April 23rd, the Soviet leader Lenin declared that the civil war was over and that his side had won. It can be said with certainty that, in the main, the civil war has ended. On the internal front, reaction has been irretrievably smashed by the efforts of the insurgent people. Even before the volunteer army's defeat at Yekaterinodar, Lenin had sounded a similar note. Quote, a wave of civil war swept over all of Russia, and everywhere we won victory with extraordinary ease. End quote. We suffer from an optical illusion. Looking back, we know the scale of the civil war of 1918 to 1920, so we don't see the civil war of 1917 to 18. There had been fighting of a very serious character on every point of the compass. There was a bloody battle when the Red Guards reached Kiev. A Tsarist army corps made up of Polish soldiers revolted in Belarus. A street fight erupted in Irkutsk in Siberia. A warlord named Semyonov raided and rampaged beyond Lake Baikal. Cossacks in the south of the Ural Mountains rose up and seized Orenburg. Everywhere, however, the result was the same. In response to these challenges, local workers and poor peasants volunteered for Red Guard units, usually in their thousands or even their tens of thousands. There was, to be clear, no Red Army yet. It had not been established. This was the time of the Otryad, the detachment, numbering anything from a few dozen to thousands, armed with anything from a few rifles to armored trains, or even in the case of Irkutsk, bows and arrows. Just like on the Don, everywhere political appeals were decisive. The Red Guards knew how to disarm the enemy with class politics. When that failed, they had their rifles. Victor Serge wrote that this wave of struggle was one with neither excesses nor terror. Although Lenin grumbled that it would be good to shoot speculators on the spot, actually, they didn't shoot speculators on the spot. In general, the noises from key Bolshevik leaders indicated that they believed the Russian Revolution, unlike the French, could avoid terror. It was a democratic regime. In the early part of the year, the government was a coalition between the Bolsheviks and the left SRs. The Third Congress of Soviets met on January 15th, around the time the Don Cossacks split. At this Congress, we see not just Bolsheviks and left SRs, but also right SRs, Menshevik internationalists, and anarchists. It's striking that the right SRs were tolerated, even though they had taken part in a counter-revolutionary uprising. This was how things stood in the military situation and the political regime in early spring 1918. The violence appeared to be over. At the end of April, the forces of the White Guards consisted of several thousand men, encircled and leaderless, on a blasted steppe on the very edge of Russia. At that moment, the first Red Army units had been formed, but they did not face the Don or the Volga. They faced the German armies to the west. That spring, a renewal of the war with Germany seemed far more likely than a new wave of civil war. Now we know that the real civil war had not even begun. What had just taken place was barely a prelude. Beginning in May, a chain of catastrophes would fan the dying embers of armed struggle to an inferno that would not die down until the end of 1920, and that would still be blazing in parts of Russia as late as 1923. What the Red Guards had just endured was nothing compared to what was coming down the line. A bloody summer was on the way. The war of irregular detachments that had triumphed by the Don and Kuban rivers would fall far short of the challenges that were to come. Tune into future episodes to see how this war started and unfolded. Thanks for listening. Berbua, Anlucht Ibra Abu.